Prusa is back. This is their new Core 1 3D printer that I've been testing on and off for the past month or so now. And yeah, I think Prusa has a good reputation for a good reason. This machine has made some of the nicest quality prints that I've ever seen. But it does also come with some quirks, some weird design choices, and a few things that you should probably know before you take the plunge and pick one up for yourself. But first, let's get it set up and start printing. It includes the iconic Prusa test receipt, instruction guide, stickers, gummy bears, lubricant, IPA and spare nylon rivets, the default smooth build plate, and some Galaxy Black Prusa mint. This stuff is hard to get a hold of in Australia, so I'm always happy to get my hands on it. There's also some anti-vibration feet included, which just stick onto the bottom. The next step was to attach the screen, which was simple enough, then to peel off all the protective wrap. I also made sure to update to the latest firmware and eat a handful of gummy bears while waiting for that. Anyway, then it just ran through the initial setup. I used the NFC thingy on the back of the printer to set up Wi-Fi, linked my Prusa account, which is completely optional, I just like the convenience, and then it ran through some self-tests and finished the setup process. But enough setup, let's print some stuff. I'll be using this Galaxy Purple PLA, which looks amazing. Also, don't make the same mistake as me, I realized I just destroyed this resealable bag. I'm just not used to filament coming packaged like this. Whoops. And here's my first print, my maker coin on the default smooth sheet, and using the default 0.2mm speed layer height settings. This quality is about what I'd expect. There is a small layer adhesion issue on the bottom, which is a common issue given the complex first layer of my maker coin, especially when using a smooth build plate. So instead, I swapped it over to the textured satin build plate, and this time it had no issues. I greatly prefer textured plates just so much more. They just make my life so much easier, and I can't actually remember using the smooth plate again after this. I also printed this one using the 0.2mm structural preset, which is a bit slower than the speed setting, obviously. I'm not sure how well it's captured on camera, but it definitely feels a lot smoother. Anyway, this is a clear pass for my maker coin test, and it also passed my next test, the fried egg test, in an impressive 9 minutes.
That's good.
So let's print something bigger. I have this mini projector that I want to mount up here above my bedhead, so I quickly designed this and then sent it over to the Core 1. The supports all came off super clean, they barely left a trace. I then slapped on some protective pads so it wouldn't scratch up my walls or bedhead, then used this M4 screw that I found on my floor to mount the projector. I genuinely have no idea where this came from, I've never seen it before, and I'm a bit concerned it fell off something important, but anyway, the projector mount worked flawlessly. But there was one problem, these bumps right here. If I had to guess, these are caused by the nozzle colliding with the infill pattern. Maybe. So I modeled up a quick test recreating the exact same angle and exact same print settings, then printed it using both the 0.2mm speed and structural presets. It's a bit harder to see on these test pieces, but the infill is a bit more visible on the speed version. Now, this test doesn't really prove anything, these are both still really good prints, but going forward I'll be using the structural preset for final high quality parts, and the speed preset for prototyping, which I'm assuming is as intended anyway. I'm going to print some more stuff soon, but first, Prusa sent me some more stuff. You've already seen the Galaxy Black PLA, but they also sent over some Orange PETG, Jet Black PETG, Galaxy Green PLA, Galaxy Silver PLA, and Galaxy Purple PLA. Now, the cool thing about Prusamint is that each roll includes a graph of the diameter tolerance, and if you scan the code, you can see all these crazy specs, recommended print settings, and so on. Plus, I got a cap, another cap, a mug that has all the Prusa Slicer keyboard shortcuts, a spare nozzle and nozzle adapter, a beanie, a mouse pad shaped like a build plate, and this is actually my Mark III build plate right here, which is fully compatible with the Core 1, which is nice. They have different printed patterns on them, but they're fully compatible with one another. And finally in my goodie bag is this textured satin build plate, which again, you've already seen. And if you want any of these, you can actually pick them up from the Printables reward shop by exchanging your Prusa points. Plus, if you use code Bryce at checkout, you can get up to 200 bonus points, so link in the description if you're keen. Anyway, back to printing. I saw Uncle Jesse had printed a giant brick separator, and I immediately knew I wanted one of those as well, just maybe not as big. So this one is actually printing with the Prusa Orange Pet G, and I usually avoid printing with Pet G because it can be stringy and the overhangs and support regions just aren't as nice as PLA, but for functional parts, Pet G is just far superior thanks to its strength, heat resistance, and flexibility. It's actually what's in use for all the printed parts on this machine, like the screen mount and the handles, so if you can pull it off, it can definitely be worth it. And I'm happy to say that the settings seem to be pretty well dialed in here. This is just about the best you can get Pet G looking, at least from my experience with it anyway. Okay, next up is Benchy, but brickier. This is a Lego compatible Benchy remix I've been working on, and I have no idea if it's going to work or if it's going to float, but I guess there's only one way to find out. I ended up printing this one with a 0.25mm speed settings because it's just a prototype. I don't care if it looks amazing, I just want to test it as fast as I can. The only change I ended up making was setting it to 3 perimeter walls, just to absolutely make sure that no water was going to creep its way inside this thing. And I also designed a little mounting point for this wind-up motor. Again, I'm unsure if it's actually going to work, but I'm happy to see that the Lego bricks fit nice and snug. Now, does it actually float? No, turns out it's way too top heavy and keeps wanting to roll itself over. Now, I could go back to square one and redesign the whole thing from scratch, but I think I've found an easier and slightly hackier way to fix this issue. But first, if you're also struggling with prototyping, maybe you could use PCBWay. They do PCB prototyping and production, 3D printing in almost every material you can think of, CNCing, and so much more. And their website is super simple to use. Just upload your file, select the material you want, then they handle the hard manufacturing part and ship it out to you when it's done. They've made so many parts for me that I just can't manufacture by myself. Like this aluminium CNC'd mold, these 3D printed parts, more CNC'd parts, this other 3D printed part, and even more CNC'd parts. And I'm working on a new design that PCBWay is manufacturing for my next video, so let me know down below if you can guess what it is. Plus, check out the link below to save $5 on your first order, and thank you to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. Okay, so what I'm thinking is that I'll design an outrigger that attaches to Benchy to basically turn it into a trimmerin. And here it is. I'll figure out how to properly attach it later, so for now I'll just tape it on. And it floats, so this looks like a success to me. The next phase was improving the design, so I added these slots so that the outrigger can be slid into place and then adjusted as needed. Plus, I made the bottom side much flatter, which should avoid these nasty overhang issues that I encountered with the test print, as well as improve the overhangs on the top part here, and move the motor mount down by about a centimeter so that the motor actually makes contact with the water. I luckily did a test print of the rails before I committed to the full print, and it did fit, but it was a bit too tight, so I added a little more tolerance and then started printing the final bricky Benchy model. This was printed with the 0.2mm structural preset, and honestly, this print came out insane. Usually with a medium-sized print like this, I'd be able to point out something that isn't, you know, 100% ideal. But again, honestly, this is the most flawless print that I've ever done. If we look back to the speedy version, there's color inconsistency, bad support connections, some of the layer lines are more prominent, and the whole surface is just a bit more matte. But the final structural version here, it's smooth, consistent, and there's no color inconsistency or prominent layer lines. Every angle is flawless in a way that I've just never seen before. I know it's a relatively basic print, maybe I'm fanning too much. I promise I've seen high quality prints before, of course, just never this consistent. I then switched back over to the Orange Pet G and printed the new Outrigger model as well, and minus some stringing on top, I don't have any complaints. And look at this thing go. I'm incredibly happy with both the 3D model I made here and with, of course, the print quality as well. And by the time you're watching this video, I should have hopefully have uploaded this to printables by now if you want to make one yourself. Alrighty, before we do some more prints, let's quickly talk about some of the choices that were made with this machine. Firstly, and I apologize for this one because you'll never be able to unsee it, but this machine isn't symmetrical. The build platform is slightly to the left, as you can see here, and this looks like it was done so that a full filament spool can fit on the right-hand side pocket, and I wrongly assumed I'd be able to store a spare roll of filament on the left side, but that side's too narrow. Of course, this doesn't affect performance in any way, it's just weird. Personally, I would have preferred it to be symmetrical and just have the filament roll stick out a bit, but please let me know what you think down below. Next are these annoying plastic rivets. I hate them. Don't get me wrong, I fully understand their utility, but they're fiddly and just don't feel like they belong on a premium machine like this. Though I can't deny that they do make disassembly easy, and if you want to print any custom mods, all of these mounting points all over the machine are going to be excellent for you. And that brings us to the top panel. There's a little manual vent that you can open and close, and depending on which filament you're printing with, it'll tell you to either open or close it. Plus, it'll also tell you to close the front door if the sensor detects that it's open. And to remove the top panel completely, you'll need to take out 4 plastic rivets. For a machine that feels incredibly solid and well built, these plastic panels and the plastic rivets definitely feel like they devalue the whole thing. I'm definitely going to be adding some magnets to my plastic panels so I never have to worry about these damn rivets again, and I really hope Prusa makes the same change in the next iteration of this machine, whenever that is. And while we're talking about the top side of this machine, there is support for the multi-material upgrade if you want to print with multicolor. However, there isn't yet an official MMU specifically for the core one. So my understanding is that if you already own an MMU from a previous Prusa machine, you should be able to hook it up and start printing fine, but there should be an MMU made specifically for the core one on its way sometime. In the meantime, I'll be placing my SpacePi X4 filament dryer up here, only the very best for my expensive Prusa mint collection. Creality sent this over for me to check out and it's been very nice. Let me know if you want some more information about this thing. I might actually make a short video about it after I've had time to test it some more, so make sure to subscribe if you don't want to miss that. But anyway, let's take a quick break and print something else. So I want to utilize this space here on the left, and thankfully Prusa have released the raw step file, which is honestly what every manufacturer should be doing, and this made it incredibly easy for me to measure the dimensions and angles and design this simple tray. A simple PETG print, but it came out well, and I was going to glue some magnets onto it to mount it like that, but tape did the job just as well. And because Prusa has open sourced these files, there's a heap of mods that people have already made that either attach with magnets or through the existing rivet holes, and a few interesting ones that I've seen so far are this draw mod, scatters mod, magnetic tool holder, and this really intense looking dry box. Prusa definitely understand their core audience, and the core one is a modder's dream. One thing that I did find a bit weird though was the lack of an inbuilt camera. It's pretty much a given that most 3D printers will include a camera these days, especially in this price range, but the reason for this, if you didn't know, is that Prusa makes almost everything in-house in Europe. And if you don't understand why that's insane, you'll just need to believe me that this is a huge accomplishment, like even before considering the price point that they're competing at, but they're still not able to produce everything in Europe, so that's why they have the Buddy 3D sub-brand, which makes official Prusa products, they're just manufactured externally. So that's the reasoning that they chose to have the Buddy 3D camera as an optional add-on, but still, it's a bit weird that this isn't at least offered in a discounted bundle or something. I also printed these stackable crates in Galaxy Black PLA, and the overhangs here performed exceptionally. I didn't use any supports at all. I did at one point run into a nozzle cleaning error, which I've seen other people complain about, but I just started the print again and it worked fine. Now, before I give you my final thoughts about the Core 1, here are some quick specs. The build volume is 250 by 220 by 270, there's an Ethernet port, and the Wi-Fi module can be completely removed if needed. It includes a high-flow brass 0.4mm nozzle, it's compatible with the hackerboard for hardcore modders, and it starts at $1,550 Australian dollars. It's true that it's not cheap, and I know a lot of people who watch my channel are on the younger side and might be a bit disappointed here, but the truth is that people don't buy Prusa because they're inexpensive. People buy Prusa because they're easily repairable, believe strongly in open source, have good support, are made in the EU, and are just plain polished. You simply can't say most of those things about a lot of other 3D printer brands out there today. So from my initial printing experience in this video, and despite some of my earlier complaints about it, I'm very pleased with the Core 1. It is an extremely solid, function over form 3D printer. And you'll definitely be seeing this machine around a lot more on my channel. I did plan to do an X1C comparison here at the end, but my X1C seems to have a few problems that I just can't seem to permanently resolve right now. right now, but let me know what else you'd like to see in the future or if you have any questions at all. Cheers.